Welcome to the Global Technology Summit 2016. I want to welcome you all on behalf of Carnegie India and say a big thank you for joining us this morning. I was told that getting an audience in on a weekday in Bangalore is not easy. I'd rather have a problem of plenty, which I'm beginning to have, but thank you all for being here and showing such enthusiasm. We are looking forward to the next 2 days of engaging conversations and insightful discussions on the future of innovation, policy making, and regulation. As we say, Global Technology Summit is the place where technology actually meets policy. Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, India, is a part of a 100-year-old global think tank and the sixth international center of Carnegie Endowment. We opened in April this year in New Delhi, and as with Carnegie's other centers in Beijing, Beirut, Brussels, Moscow, and Washington, Carnegie India is staffed and led by local experts who collaborate extensively with colleagues around the world. The center's research focus includes the political economy of reforms in India, foreign and security policy, and the role of innovation and technology in India's internal transformation and international relations. It will build on decades of scholarship on the region, and as we have done in the past, will continue to contribute through its cutting-edge research and deep thinking towards national policies and high-level strategic discussions. The Technology Forum initiative based out of Bangalore aims to do exactly that when it comes to tech and policy. As I said, Global Technology Summit is where technology meets policy. A lot of people in Bangalore and in Delhi have asked us why Bangalore and will it be a one-time effort, a two-day jamboree, and after that you will vanish and come back the next year once again. And we say no, the answer is exactly the opposite. The summit is just the launch. We are extending our program to Bangalore, Bengaluru, the heart of the innovation hub, to work on technology and policy. And every quarter we will have an engagement throughout the year for years to come. This is because we felt and feel that like technology cannot have a tunnel vision and exist in vacuum, policies cannot live in the past and always play catch up. When they do, we end up in situations where innovation starts getting stifled and slows down. Ideal situation, as some would say, is for policymakers to stay out of the game. But that's not real and shouldn't be the rule either, since technology touches us all. And if something is as pervasive as tech and digital disruption is, government and policymakers will have a say in governing it. Question is, how do they do it? They need new ideas, continuous conversations, and engagement. And these new ideas also have to evolve at the same pace as digital disruption is. And this is exactly what Carnegie India plans to do and will do. Study new ideas, look at the future trends, future of tech, future of disruption, and future of policymaking. Never before in the history of our country has the talk of technology been at the center stage of policymaking. In a lot of ways, technology is now at the core of what we do. If I may borrow from my colleague and fellow at Carnegie, Anand Padmanabhan, he calls it technology centrality. From education to health, from leisure to commerce, from governance to diplomacy, everything is about digital, tech, disruption, and innovation. Words like AI, machine learning, robotics, data analytics, and big data are now a part of our everyday language. But what are the frameworks in which these will survive and thrive? That's what we hope to achieve between today and tomorrow with innovators, policymakers, and academics. I do want to take the opportunity to thank some people here on the ground. I do not want to wait for the vote of thanks at the end, and this is not a vote of thanks. This is just to acknowledge that when we started talking about the initiative, it was just a few months ago, and it's only December, and we managed to put this together, and it couldn't have happened without the support of some very, very key people. The three I will name at the very start are, they are very much intertwined and a part of our Carnegie Endowment. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, you must give her a big round of applause. She's not just a Bengaluru leader, but she's also someone who is a great guide for all of us. Mohandas Pai, who I'm sure has still not shown up because he's busy with something else, but Mohandas Pai is pretty much the star of what he has been telling us and telling us to do. R.K. Mishra, also somebody who you all know from a Bengaluru city point of view. If you want to get anything fixed, call RK. And we wanted to get Carnegie off the ground, so we called RK as well. And then, of course, there is Sharad Sharma of iSpirit, who's been a great guide as well. Great flag bearer and also a partner to us at the summit. But just a few people who are also helping us to put this together. First off, the Ministry of External Affairs, Dr. Jaishankar, and your vision and your very, very able officer, Mr. Nagaraj Naidu, who's also with us from the Foreign Ministry. He heads the Economic Diplomacy Division. The government of Karnataka for being a state partner, led by Sri R.B. Deshpande, who will be a speaker tomorrow, and Priyank Kharge is the IT minister. Thank you, Karnataka, and thank you, Bengaluru. Our summit partners, Flipkart, thank you, Sachin, Ola, thank you, Bhavish, and most important, I must admit, Nivriti Rai, who's also here, the head of Intel from day one. And on day one, she said Intel will be a part of this, as she believes and they believe India is where the future is. Thank you, Nivriti, for being with us. Our session partners, Volvo, Dell EMC, Sarv, thank you so much. And finally, a huge, huge, huge shout out for the team led by Target, Navneet Kapoor, and his team of Rakesh, Dhirendra, and Suresh, without who you would not see what you are seeing actually. The attention to perfection and attention to detail is something I've learned over the last few weeks working with them. So here we are, the Global Technology Summit 2016 is all here and set to begin.
Say a few words, I mean at least three broad sets of points at the outset. One, I think the challenge of India's economic and social modernization, which was the objective of India's national movement, the 100-year-old India's national movement, remains unfulfilled. I think it's a matter of deep regret for the entire elite of this country that nearly 70 years after independence, we are still some distance away from actually delivering the basics to a large number of people. I think that's a reality, and I think anything we do must start with that reality. I think the political class, the intellectual class, I think we've tended to take the paths of least resistance, avoid doing hard things which are needed to do good with the people. But I think at this point at least, we see the present government, the Prime Minister, at least willing to take bold decisions, hard decisions, cut the Gordian knot where it need be, and that the demonetization shows you that difficult and disruptive as these decisions are, finally, there is some political will in Delhi to take those hard steps to move India forward. And I think that brings me to the second point. I believe the idea of demonetization could not have worked, could not even have a chance to work without the technological dimensions of it. That is, without the kind of technology that we have today, it was impossible to conceive of where you're going to take out such a large percentage of cash in circulation in the Indian economy. Therefore, I think this brings us to the larger point. I mean, I think that the need to mobilize technology, the technological revolution that's unfolding today, for India's internal transformation and to elevate its international position, I think are absolutely important. And I think that's where the challenge and the focus of much of the discussion here today and tomorrow is going to be. That all of us know that the developments that are taking place today, from artificial intelligence to robotics to the 3D printing and the range of technological changes that are taking place today, promise extraordinary possibilities for leapfrogging India's development. But they're also deeply disruptive. I mean, I think that's where the problem is going to be for us. The tension between promoting technology, which is there at hand, which is in front of us, and to prevent its use for negative purposes, to make sure that the social concerns, the economic concerns, the concerns of equity are equally represented when we make policy. So the tension between regulation on the one hand and promotion on the other is deep. And I think we need to deal with it. Second, I think as we bring in the new technologies to transform our economy, we also got to make sure that it does not lead to expansive unemployment. And I think dealing with that problem too is going to be quite central. There is also the question, I think, of the ways in which a range of ethical concerns, I mean, I think do come up, whether it is the question of privacy, the role of state versus citizen, or the question of how much of a biotechnology research are going to do, what is going to be the regulation, and how we're going to deal with those issues, they're also going to be important. That brings me to the third set of issues, which is really to cope with the challenges of the new technology and to make full use of its possibilities. I think we need a real partnership between policymakers in Delhi and those who make those who are developing technology, those who are doing innovation in cities like Bangalore, Hyderabad, and different places. So therefore, this connection of establishing a deep interrelationship of synergy between Delhi and Bangalore in many ways is the big problem. But there, I think, we have a historical sense that it's not easy to bring these two sets of people together. It was 60 years ago, a man called C.P. Snow, he was a scientist and a writer, who talked about the dangers of two cultures evolving separately. The world of science and the world of humanities and politics, that these two were evolving differently. C.P. Snow said, we can paraphrase it, the technologists have the future in their bones, but the political leaders wish the future does not happen because it's too inconvenient, too disruptive. So therefore, I think the tension that exists between concerns of those who are ruling the country, the bureaucratic leadership or the political leadership, and the possibilities of technology that we see beginning to happen, I think navigating and managing the tension, that is the greatest challenge. I think that is where the focus of this conference for the next 2 days is going to be. But I believe that barrier between the two different cultures is not difficult to overcome because Bangalore itself is a great example. For example, the Indian Institute of Science was set up here, an interesting collaboration between an industrialist, Jamshedji Tata, and the Mysore Royal family. Eventually, of course, you had to get the permission from the British Raj, and who brought in interesting scientists from abroad. But I think the important thing was the idea was triggered by a chance meeting between Swami Vivekananda and Jamshedji Tata on a ship sailing to Vancouver. That actually you saw completely different class of characters. A Swamiji, an industrialist, a royal family, and the Raj had to come together to produce what is today one of the finest technological science centers in the world. I think that is the kind of partnership we need. But I think over the last many years, while technology was important, we tended to bureaucratize the kind of relationship that has existed between the political leadership and the technologists. What was a vibrant relationship under Nehru, because it was small, you could do it. But today you need a different forms of management of the relationship between Delhi and Bangalore. And I think to discuss those issues, I think we have two wonderful speakers. And both of them, interestingly, one is a policymaker, Dr. Jaishankar, who is the foreign secretary and has had the diplomatic service of almost 40 years now. We have Mr. R.S. Sharma, who is currently the chairman of the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. Both of them, interestingly, have navigated this tension between technology and policy. Mr. Sharma was trained as a mathematician. He went on to join the Indian Civil Service, where he had spent long years. He was in charge of Department of Information Technology. He was also the mission director for what we now call the Aadhaar mission. And I think it tells you that actually you can do interesting things that where the knowledge of technology and the kind of creation of platforms that we've seen done. Jaishankar, of course, had, background in chemistry, trained as a chemist. And then he worked, his PhD was on the nuclear issues. And we've seen much of Mr. Jaishankar's work as a diplomat has been in this intersection of politics and diplomacy, of technology and diplomacy, where he had to deal with overcoming India's technological isolation for the 40 years. That after the nuclear test, India was put into the doghouse by the international system. Even importing the smallest pin for a technology company was impossible because the kind of regulations that had come in. And I think much of his work in the last few years has gone to end India's nuclear isolation, to negotiate a framework with the Americans to resolve the nuclear problem. And right now he's engaged in getting India's membership of the what we call the Wassenaar arrangement, which controls the transfers of high technology goods. And hopefully we'll have good news for us at some point. I think it is the changing the international conditions under which Indian technology thrives has been a major mission for this government, and I think success in the direction is going to create a whole new possibilities for us. But
good morning, everybody. Let me begin by saying it's a great pleasure to be with all of you at this Global Technology Summit. The origins of this particular event actually lie in a conversation that Mohandas Pai and I had in Mumbai some months ago, and I'm really delighted that we could move what was a casual discussion in another event in Mumbai into an actual event in Bangalore. And I really can't think of a more appropriate place to do this than Bangalore, because it is a city which has a very special place in the evolution of modern Indian science and technology. And I know it, my formative years were spent in this city. And it's not just the science and technology, I think it also has a very unique place in Indian industry. And thereafter in the history of our information technology and innovation. So in all those roles, Bangalore actually has been a bridge to the world at a time when technological progress is acquiring global dimensions. Now, over the next 2 days, you will be discussing different aspects of innovation and its impact on Indian society. As you deliberate on these issues, and I recognize each one of those issues is a world unto itself, I ask myself what value that I, as a practicing diplomat, can bring to your discussions. Probably the most helpful thing I can do is to set a context, an international one and a national one. And as I said again, Bangalore is just the right place to do so. So let me start with the international side. I would ask you all to reflect on the fact that the changes that we are today in the midst of in India, these are not unique, even if they have very strong national characteristics. Anybody who's looked at comparative change will tell you that beginning with Japan 150 years ago, then Russia as Soviet Union, the Asian tiger economies, and then China. We've actually had a succession of agrarian economies that transformed themselves into industrial societies. Each one of them had their own particular catalyst, but at the end of the day, they shared one common feature. They all strategized change. They may have begun to by doing the reforms that they must, but they ended by doing the change that they wished. In each case, this had profound social and technological repercussions and transformed the nation, the society in question, as a serious player in international politics. So by that yardstick, where do we in India stand today? Obviously, as a society that has been in the midst of rapid change since 1991, the natural inclination is to assume that we too are on the same track. Yet, it's worth asking ourselves, and I think Dr. Rajamohan started that discussion, whether we have pursued the path of reform as single-mindedly, as assiduously, as comprehensively as these other states. Have we consciously striven to move beyond change mandated by compulsion, to embrace a more ambitious developmental vision of our own future? A large part of the debate over the last 25 years has been in freeing up the economy and creating new opportunities. As someone who can remember the period before 1991, I would hardly underestimate its significance. Indeed, this year we have some very interesting books on that subject. But what has become clear as years passed was that we have actually fallen short in many respects in our transition to a major industrialized economy. In particular, our limitations in building substantial manufacturing capacities are evident. But equally, there are attitudes and habits that come with change that India is still to fully internalize. Today, we endeavor to take a broader and more intensive path of reform, one that bears perhaps a little more similarity to some of the examples I mentioned earlier. Expanding manufacturing and generating employment are key goals. Equally in play are creation of conditions to make that possible, among them the skilling of our workforce and the closing of the gender gap. Indeed, if you look at the cumulative impact of various national campaigns and initiatives that have been announced in the last 2 years, Make in India, Skill India, Swachh Bharat, Digital India, Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao, Smart Cities, and Startup India, the outlines of a larger thinking that aspires to rapidly progress and modernize India are quite visible. It's a comprehensive vision that balances manufacturing and services, urban and rural, and the future and the past. Do also bear in mind that even as they go forward, we are moving towards a more unified and less informal economy. There's no reason to doubt that the aggregate outcome of all these developments would be as impactful on the world as those of others who have taken the path before us. This is the future for which you must plan and prepare. Now, while making the case that India's quest has some precedents, let me balance that argument with the point that there are indeed some singular points in our endeavor. One, India is alone in attempting such sweeping transformation in a democratic framework. Two, this exercise is taking place in a more pluralistic social environment. These socio-political realities are the causes, perhaps, for a more evolutionary and painstaking approach till now. While hard to quantify, they nevertheless leave little doubt that this heterogeneity not only promotes creativity in India, but could condition us to be more effective in our interactions with the world. Global developments over the last century have been driven by two broad currents. One is the intensive and continuous technological and innovation development of Euro-Atlantic societies that own the first industrial revolution. The other is the quantitative and qualitative transformation of Asian societies that I've spoken about. Their merging today provides the motor that drives the global economy and constitutes the core of the emerging international order. The world is not only getting flatter, it is also getting more interpenetrative. This obviously has implications for the conduct of international relations, but equally for the diffusion of technologies and sharing of innovations. Most important, the terms of engagement between the two currents is changing rapidly. External relations have a particularly important role to play in promoting development and hastening social change. In each of the cases I mentioned earlier, their governments made a concerted effort to attract technologies, best practices, and capital from abroad. Indeed, it was often the external inputs that provided the catalytic elements. India's case is perhaps somewhat different. On the one hand, our levels of stability are much higher and our path of progress much steadier. To that extent, we could perhaps contemplate many of the transformational initiatives as coming from within. That said, the role of NRIs and persons of Indian origins in promoting change is hard to overstate. Our engagement with the world is taking many forms, among them global partnerships that widen technology access, regime memberships that help set policy and regulate activity, as well as promotional initiatives that advance our interests in larger forums. The India-US nuclear understanding and subsequent follow-up with other countries, the most recent was with Japan, are notable in that regard, not just for their immediate impact on the nuclear industry, but also as an enabler of larger, broader technological interflows. The membership of the nuclear suppliers group, the missile technology control regime, and the Wassenaar arrangement are natural progressions. That the focus of our diplomacy today is on examples like the International Solar Alliance, the Defense Trade and Technology Initiative with the United States, or the Shinkansen High-Speed Rail Project with Japan, speaks volumes of our changed thinking. When the Prime Minister of India visits Tesla, Google, and Facebook, there's a clear message. Even more so when he takes a personal interest in startups at home. Technology, of course, is a key driver of economic and social development. When it comes to international relations, it is often asserted, not without basis, that sharp changes in technology levels have led to shifting balances in power. Indeed, the story of war and of politics is one of human ingenuity and capabilities from medieval times when the arrow and the armor competed, or as did fortification and siege craft. Gunpowder and metallurgy are other big game-changing examples. And as we move into the industrial age, it has actually been success has been correlated with standardization. But the point I would emphasize is, though the narrative often focuses on materials and technology, at every stage, there has been an accompanying and profound shift of culture. In fact, it is that culture which permeates through society and brings about the change in the habits, the discipline, the attitude, and perhaps even the ambitions of that society. As a diplomat, I'm conscious today that this mindset can really lead India to look at the world in a very different way. A more tech-focused India has considerable implications for not just public policy, but I believe also for our approach to engaging the world. Now, within the government, it is well known that applications of technology is acquiring a more salient place. Whether it is the Pragati conference that the Prime Minister takes to assess important projects, or the e-samiksha that monitors implementations of decisions, or the Madad platform by which my ministry monitors and receives and addresses consular problems and grievances, these practices today have got very rapidly routinized. Similarly, the communications world has undergone its revolution, and the social media, to my mind, is a great example of direct benefit transfer. The broader direction of our society is towards an embrace of technology on a scale and manner that we could not have even conceived of a few years earlier. The challenge is to expand the human resources that could lead and sustain this trend. If India is to emerge as a truly leading power in the world, it can do so only when its human resources are brought into full play. As with other aspects of reform, we cannot leave it to osmosis and gravity. All the major modernizing societies before us have made this issue central to their strategizing. Given the nature of our society, this responsibility cannot and should not rest in the government alone. We are seeing a determined effort today to expand both skilling and education at various levels. Taking that into technology and innovation calls not just for higher levels of commitment, but also greater imagination and more commercialization. This is an area where we can leverage global interest, taking advantage of the fact that the world itself has an interest in diversifying the geographies of technology. Concerns of excessive dependence on a few are already visible in many sectors. Furthermore, India itself needs to think of customizing training and skills preparation for specific markets. There's a strong cultural element to how we work and how we think, and partnerships with countries like Japan and Germany are more likely to be successful if they factor in languages and skills. Now, all of you know much better than me that a very different world awaits us. It is a world of greater digitalization and innovation, as it is of a very different connection and communication. The passage into modernity should make us richer including in data. But this, and this will have its own challenges. Our value proposition to the world will also transform itself. India's association must not be that of frugal innovation alone. The adjective could end up overpowering the noun. The space industry, centered in Bangalore, is a trendsetter for the world that could open up for the larger tech industry. More branding, greater deployment, and stronger commercialization is the way by which Indian technology can make itself felt in the world. I hope as we are seeking to do in our national aspirations and foreign policy goals, the tech community will also think bigger and aim higher. At the end of the day, as B.F. Skinner famously said, the real problem is not whether machines can think, but whether humans do. Thank you.
Morning, friends. It's always a pleasure to come to Bangalore. I was telling Sharad that I must have visited Bangalore about 100 times. It was when I was in Aadhaar, 2009 to 2013, we used to have one, conference, what we call tech conference in Bangalore. And that was a technology review of UID. Carnegie India has really done a wonderful job of assembling this all together. And I think it's a very good opportunity for us to showcase what India has done in terms of technology, what India is doing in terms of policy, and Dr. Jaishankar has already laid out the broad, high-level picture of that. So I think they really deserve commendation on that, and I'm thankful to them for inviting me and so that I could share my thoughts. Initially, I thought that as a TRAI chairman, I'll talk about what TRAI is doing in the telecom space and regulating and all that. But after I talked to some of my friends from Carnegie India, as also Sharad, they advised me that this whole discussion should be about what India has done in the technology space and what exactly also has been done in the policy space, both these spaces. So it is not just writing codes and doing technology, but it's also strategic thinking and ultimately mixing that and actually creating a policy framework also, which actually allows innovations, which allows startups to come in and all that thing. So I think what I'll do is, I have two propositions to make. One is that India has done certain really, really unique things in the technology space, and I'll give a couple of examples of that. And secondly, in the policy space as well, in the regulatory space as well, and specifically taking my TRAI's case, we have done certain unique things, and actually we are in a position to lead the world in those spaces, and the world is already watching us in that sense. So as Dr. Jaishankar said, that our prime minister, the new government, came to power in May of 2014. And thereafter, I was at that time working as secretary in one of the departments of Government of India. And I was told that we have to have a vision of digital India. And typically, like bureaucrats, we said, oh, digital India would consist of this project, that project, and stuff like that. So we submitted our proposition, and he said, no, this is not is digital India. This is not what is digital India. Digital India should be conceived of as to what should be the desirable attributes which a digitally empowered India should have. And that's where the whole journey began, to articulate all the attributes of digital India. And what came out actually met the approval of the Prime Minister, and he launched it. It's essentially, I see digital India as at three levels. So broadly, the aim of digital India is to sort of transform India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. And there are three layers. The first layer is the digital infrastructure as a utility to citizens. So we should have digital infrastructure. That's the first thing which we should do. And on top of that digital infrastructure, we should have that software layer, which is basically software and services which should be available to citizens on demand. And the third layer, the most important one, is citizens empowerment. Because second layer cannot work unless the ground layer is there. The third layer, second layer also cannot work unless the citizens have the empowerment to use this digital infrastructure and software and services. So there are three broad areas, and what I'm going to focus is what has been done by our country in terms of digital infrastructure. So let me take two examples. The first is digital identity infrastructure. This is basically one of the aims of Digital India is to provide digital identity from grave, from birth, cradle to grave, to all the citizens of this country. So digital identity infrastructure is actually the basis of other kinds of stuff which takes place on top of it, and I'll speak a little bit about that. Of course, connectivity, ubiquitous connectivity, broadband as a utility to citizens is another digital infrastructure which we must have, and unfortunately we are not very greatly ahead in terms of that. That is somehow one of our weak things. But on the digital identity infrastructure, we have created Aadhaar, which is now 1.07 billion strong. Out of 1.3 billion people in this country, India has done Aadhaar and provided unique identity numbers to 1.07 billion, 107 crores people have Aadhaar today. And more or less 90% of all the adults of this country have the unique identity. And people will say, what is so great about this unique identity? After all, you just give a number to one person, you didn't even provide these smart cards. So why are you so proud of that? And what's so unique about it? So one is, it is unique, which means only one person can have only one identity number. It is unique to the extent that the authority which was created to create this identity was named as Unique Identification Authority of India. And I always wondered, whether this unique is authority or the identification. So this is unique, and that actually has lots and lots of value propositions. One is that, if there are, lots of duplicates and fakes in our programs. And just to give you an idea, we provide direct subsidy to order of 500 lakh crores. And even if you consider 10%, which is an underestimation of duplicates and ghosts, the actually leakage is taking place is 50,000 crores per annum. And Aadhaar will just plug that. It has already started plugging. In fact, LPG subsidy, we have a saving of 20,000 crores per annum. And you know what is the cost of Aadhaar? Less than 10,000 crores. Less than 10,000 crores. A project which actually costs you less than 10,000 crores, and this is 7 years maintenance included also, that has the potential and is already saving 30, 40,000 crores per annum. So this is the uniqueness proposition. Now, more importantly than uniqueness, is a proposition that it is digitally authenticable identity, which means digitally you can prove who you are. Now that's extremely, extremely important. And people just didn't understand what is this digital authentication. So what I did was, and what we did was, that we started using these attendance systems in the government. Today, 2 million people in Delhi and various state capitals, they mark attendance. And it takes less than 2 seconds. And that actually has told them, this is authentication. This is, you just go there and you plug in last 4 digits of your Aadhaar number and you just put in any of the fingers or iris and you are authenticated. Now, this is extremely, extremely important. Now, these two properties of this digital identity infrastructure have created a whole lot of products which Sharad and his friends call India Stack. It's truly, truly, you know, unique to our country. For example, from this thought that you can digitally authenticate yourself, and by the way, there are no technologies available in the world where you can have very, very robust, reliable digital authentication. People create identities, you know, private companies, Google, Facebook, all these guys are creating identities, and you know, you are having those roundabout identities. You know, if you sign in, give me your Facebook ID, and you know, I'll plug in that, so they are all circulating, and it's possible to create a digital, this identity, this kind of identity is completely fake. You know, the person doesn't exist, and he can create all the Facebooks and Googles and all kinds of things. So this is one identity which is quite different. And interestingly, it is a public good. All the other identities are commercial propositions. This is a public good which is being offered in our country. Now, on top of that, there is a whole range of things which have been done. So, for example, typical idea of a digital signature is that, you know, I go somewhere to the digital signature provider, I make an application, that person will verify that I am R.S. Sharma. After having been satisfied, he will give me a dongle, a USB dongle, which will have the, you know, these keys, public key, private key, and all that stuff. And you are signing a document, and then you plug in your USB port, and then you digitally sign the document. That's the way it happens. Now, typically, many of us who do not need to sign a document except the income tax returns and stuff like that, we give it to our chartered accountant. So the chartered accountant fellow is actually signing on our behalf. So not only we have given our signatures also to him. Now, what came out was that if I am able to digitally authenticate my identity, then why can't the private key and public key be delivered real time online? So that came the concept of what we call e-sign. And initially people said, oh, how can you do that? There is a set process, and there is an IT Act, and there is a law, and there are rules. And I said, look, if this is robust, if this is compliant with the IT Act, why can't we do it? So actually now there are a number of service providers, what we call e-sign providers. So what happens? You have a document, and then you digitally want to sign it. So you authenticate with your biometric. This authentication goes to Aadhaar UID servers, and they say, yes, this is R.S. Sharma. Immediately that e-sign provider getting hold of my identity, because that's what he's supposed to do. He's supposed to first verify my identity. After he verifies my identity, he issues those public key, private key, and the document gets signed. So you are able to, you know, convert this CAPEX model into a completely OPEX model. This digital signature dongle is costing about 1,100, 1,200 rupees. This digital signature is going to cost less than 1 rupee. That's what has happened. You created a digital locker where you will be able to dematerialize and store all the documents, and you will be able to share all the documents. So this is a situation which is actually creating a whole range of products which are paperless and which are completely digital and which satisfy all the criteria of being robust, reliable, and all the legal requirements also. So this is what we have been, India has been able to create a whole stack of technologies which are unique to India and which are creating newer and newer set of applications. You know, when we were doing Aadhaar, people thought, oh, this is great, this is going to affect privacy of individuals. And everybody was worried about privacy. There are design principles of Aadhaar where we have said it will have minimal information and all that thing, so that privacy is not really the one which is, you know, we are not going to profile people. But most importantly, today we can create a framework which protects privacy in a digital world. Give you an example. I am going to, you know, ask for a loan from some bank. The bank is going to ask everybody, all the other institutions, to see whether I had taken any, what is my financial conduct, you know, credit card companies, banking companies, etc. They can scour all my knowledge. Even when I'm not asking for a loan, they can do so for whatever purposes they want to do it for. Now, I can give a digital token to the institution and say, look, by this token, I'm authorizing you, and this token has a lifetime. You can say, okay, for next 3 days, you can go to all the credit agencies, show this token to them, and they can verify that this token is issued by me, and then they can provide this information. So there is a consent-based architecture where I am the owner of my data. Today morning, I was talking to one of the startup, you know, persons, Indranil, and he was telling me how the trucks, you know, how we want to, for logistic management, we want to manage, how we want to track the trucks. Now, obviously, for tracking the truck, you have to have the consent from the truck driver that he's ready to be tracked. And how do you get this consent? Oh, this fellow writes on a paper that, and this consent is not, cannot be permanent. After all, he's taking your luggage only today. Tomorrow he'll take somebody else's luggage. How can he give you his consent to be tracked all the time? So there are issues, and this whole architecture can be developed at a scale where it can work. Similarly, banking, for example. Now today we are talking of cashless, and there are lots and lots of things happening in the cashless part. Now, the actual transaction which can happen using Aadhaar authentication, that cost of transaction becomes very, very insignificant, and it's very important. See, India is an extremely cost-sensitive market. You know, when you had the telecom rates of 8 rupees 40 paisa per minute, you had 1 million telecom subscribers. Today, you have telecom rates of 40 paisa, less than 40 paisa per minute, you have 1 billion subscribers. So it's important for financial inclusion that the cost of transaction is driven down to actually mop up the bottom of the pyramid. And that is possible today with Aadhaar as the technology to identify and authenticate. Think of any transaction in the digital world. The first part is, who are you? First part is your identity, because a transaction is done by somebody. Of course, we are talking of human identity. There will be machine identity. You have machine-to-machine communications and all that IoT and stuff like that that's going on. But essentially, the proposal, the basic thing which I wanted to say was, India has created a whole range of technology stack. For example, UPI, the Unified Payment Interface architecture which has been built, is one of the finest architecture which actually is completely unbundled. You know, your bank account fellow can be one bank. The other person whose bank account can be another bank. He can have app of another one. I can have app of another one. And, you know, sitting in center of the NPCI. So actually, we have been able to create a robust, unbundled architecture which promotes innovation. And all these technologies actually create a lot of innovation, you know, things. Aadhaar, there have been a lot of startups, and there are a lot of startups on Aadhaar. So essentially, and this can be very effectively used as a tool of diplomacy. Just give you two examples. I was called to Morocco. World Bank had invited me. They were doing a digital ID program. And then I told them what ID India has done, and they completely converted. Similarly, I had gone to St. Petersburg from the International Finance Congress, and I talked about how financial inclusion can be promoted using this digital identity. There is a huge amount of interest. And India can, in fact, I wrote to Dr. Jaishankar's department, Dr. Jaishankar himself, that, you know, this is Morocco. And they said, yes, the vice president is going to Morocco, and we'll take this up as one of the agenda. So I think this technology, you know, leadership which India has created, and there are many other areas, I don't want to get into that, is actually sufficient and very good for taking this forward and spreading this to the world. We should not remain the IT coolies. We should really, you know, take the leadership. Now, coming to the policy, again, I want to give you one example. This is, people talked of net neutrality and say net neutrality is coming, and there were some things which happened which triggered that discussion. And our belief is that if you want the innovation ecosystem to persist, to happen, internet is extremely, extremely important from the development perspective of our country. Especially, you know, in a developing country like us, where lots and lots of startups are happening, all the banking is going on in the internet, Education will go on the internet. Agriculture will go on the internet. Internet is extremely important, and it must remain an open platform. So therefore, we created this. India was one of the first countries in the world which actually brought out, we do not have a net neutrality policy as yet, but then we tackled the immediate problem by enacting a regulation on the differential pricing, where we said, you are a pipe. The telecom service providers are a pipe. And you cannot differentiate the data flowing through your pipes on the basis of where the data came from, where the data is going to, and what does the data contain. So this policy has been, you know, hailed by many FCC and, you know, European regulators and everybody. So India is not only doing technology, India is also doing the thinking and regulation which is in sync with technology. Our philosophy in TRAI is, yes, we need to regulate because that's our job. And I think regulation is necessary in a world where different stakeholders are interconnecting and communicating with each other. You need to create open standards. You need to create regulations. You need to, you know, sort of arbitrate kind of arbitrate these communications among them. But at the same time, there are certain overarching principles which we have set for ourselves. Principle number one is that we should create a level playing field. We should be technology agnostic. That's very, very important. The second principle, which is actually should be the first principle, is the consumer protection. Ultimately, consumers' interests must be protected. That's one. Secondly, we should promote innovation and technology. Technology should not be subjected to some kind of, you know, legacy to prevent the legacy or protect the legacy products and legacy business models. No. Technology must have a full play. Innovation must have a full play. Technology and innovation must be facilitated by regulation and not throttled by it. So these are some of the guiding principles which we have, and whatever we do, we always maintain this part. Consumer centricity, technology, you know, for moving forward, and of course, level playing field, growth of the industry, certainly it's very important. And in this coming data world, obviously privacy, security, there are many other concerns which you have. There are new innovations taking place, new problems also coming up. So I think this is very, very important that India has the, you know, capability to lead the world in the technology it has created, and also lead the world in terms of the thinking, in terms of regulatory architecture and the regulatory principles which we have created. Thank you very much.
I thought I'll ask you just a couple of questions to the two gentlemen. Maybe we can have water? Sharp answers. For everyone. The lights get you. No, the first question I had was, here sitting in Bangalore, the two of you from Delhi, so am I, how do you reassure the audience here? There's so many young people trying to do various new things. Have we crossed a Rubicon in Delhi that the intellectual resistance to new things, the reluctance to, you know, remember how people used to scoff at Rajiv Gandhi's computer Rajiv Gandhi is always on his computer. To one where actually you say today the criticisms in relation to use of technology to deal with demonetization. Is there a resistance that has overcome in the governmental system and that the government is ready to do today to create space, to create policies that are going to boost the kind of things that people in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Bombay or various other places are doing? So in a sense, is Delhi ready now to give that big push in relation to boosting and creating strong domestic capabilities? Because both in Aadhaar, you had serious struggles inside, like in the nuclear deal you did. You had serious confrontations within the system. So have we crossed that Rubicon in that sense?
So let me, I think this is a very interesting question. I have been working in the government for about 40 years. I think I have never seen a much more conducive kind of environment as we have seen in the last 2.5 years. The Prime Minister himself is driving technology. He understands, you know, technology. Let me just give you an example. I hope I'll not be quoted. If you remember, please don't tweet.
It's too late, technology.
Yeah,
technology
I know.
It might be on a tweet in a 2 minutes.
No, what I'm saying is, you know, if you remember, the party which has come to power now, BJP, they were opposed to Aadhaar. You know, they were saying this will provide, I mean, a lot of reservations people had about Aadhaar. But the Prime Minister came and then he understood the value proposition. And then he was, you know, gracious enough and he said, yeah, this should be done. So whatever is the national interest should be done. So that's actually the way the whole government is working. And I really find there is a huge amount of acceptance towards new technologies. It is also, it is true that many of us in bureaucracy don't really understand the technology implications, and you know we somehow scoff at things which are not yet clear. But then thereafter, once you start using them, once you start doing them, then they say, yeah, this is a good thing which has happened. And my view is that anything which actually reduces, you know, Dr. Jaishankar talked about frugal. I would say we require frugal innovation. Innovations in a country.
But not alone.
Frugal does not always mean technologically bad. Frugal can be technologically very, very, you know, sophisticated and yet frugal. I mean, Aadhaar, the per individual cost of Aadhaar is less than 100 rupees. It's very frugal. But at the same time, it is one of the most sophisticated architecture. So essentially, what we need is actually, because India is a very, very cost-sensitive market, we need to have technologies which are cost effective, which are digital, which are transparent, traceable, all these attributes, and these attributes do exist today. Technology is there to create such products.
I would say the short answer to your question is the gap, if it exists between Delhi and Bangalore, has narrowed. I mean, first of all, I would question that the gap exists as much as people make it out to be for a variety of reasons. One is, look, there's a lot of sort of bottom-up pressure today on technology. I mean, because there has been so much sort of imbibing of technology at a popular level. I mean, look at something as simple as a phone, you know. I mean, Rajiv Gandhi didn't live in a cell phone world, or it was at least in its, but not even in its infancy, during his time. So if you look at the sort of the character of the society, I mean, we have become in the last few years much more tech-friendly society. It is not a luxury, it is not an eccentricity, you know. There's a normalcy about technology, which has actually been astounding, particularly if you look at orthodox parameters like literacy levels. That If you look at the social indicators and look at the technology characteristics of the society, it's a very interesting match. I mean, we have done a lot of leapfrogging in our technology habits, which by organic growth probably would have taken us very much longer. So, and I think if you look, again, I'm giving you now a foreign diplomatic perspective. Look at the image of India, you know. Today, a lot of places, you know, when we've often had this debate, what was the turning point where, the inflection point where people thought differently of us? And, you know, a lot of people have suggested Y2K was an answer. Because in the minds of the world, suddenly these were tech guys. You know, this perception is a very widely held international perception of Indians. And I think that also, in many ways, you know, we live up to our image, or we try to. So it's a very interesting trend, but suddenly I think the gap is, in my mind, not there or narrowing.
The second question I had, I mean, Mr. Sharma, you talked about the last few years we've created these enormous capabilities, and that this can be used by India to take leadership positions, both in terms of shaping the global debate, setting global standards, making significant interventions in technology-related issue, because it's also become a transnational thing. It's not merely national. So, Foreign Secretary, that you often talked about, I mean, what should be India's principal foreign policy goal is the quest for India must become a leading power, not a balancing power, not a non-aligned power, not a power that is you know, weak and hesitant to take positions, but one that is willing to lead and shape the international system. So in some senses, both of you are saying similar things, but where are we in terms of actually relating the capabilities to our diplomacy, both in terms of the big powers as well as the smaller countries, where we can contribute to the transformation?
You'd like to One is, of course, India itself has now been using technologies on a scale. Let's take the direct benefit transfer. Now, India is today crediting 140 million accounts per month, because there are 140 million LPG subscribers, and they are entitled to 12 cylinders a year. So 140 million. Now 140 million multiplied by 12, it becomes about 2 billion credit transactions a year. So
this is the cooking gas.
The cooking gas. So what I'm saying is that India has been using these technologies at a scale. If I may say that infrastructure happens to be a very serious constraint and bottleneck in India, especially the ICT infrastructure. Today, we have internet penetration of a very low, you know, we are behind many countries in Africa.
And also the quality of it.
The quality of that, so quality of services is an issue. So there are a lot of these infrastructural constraints. Had they not been there, probably we would have been using technology much, much more, because as I said, infrastructure is the base on which you can, you know, run your softwares and services. So that has happened. Of course, on the diplomacy front, as to how we take this forward, my limited, I mean, I'm not a diplomat, but whatever limited interaction I have had, I find that there's a huge amount of interest for countries to learn from India's experience. And they always, you know, we do become, you know, in any conferences, et cetera, people are trying to understand how we have done it, at what scale we have done it, and how that will replicate in their countries, whether they need to change anything or stuff like that. So I think there is a huge interest. Of course, Dr. Jaishankar and his team will have to take it forward. And of course, we are there behind him.
You know, I would answer the second part of your question. See, one, let me go back to the frugal innovation remark. You know, we have, in a variety of areas in this country, applied technology on a scale and a competitive cost, which is truly commendable. And I think that factor is recognized in many other societies which are very cost sensitive. So if you look at the world, you know, the world is a market, okay? All markets are segmented. So what we need to do is we have to see which part of our experience relates to which market. So there will be markets, you know, there will be countries, I mean, I can imagine parts of the world where our Aadhaar experience or I mean, we are able today to provide space launches at very competitive prices. I mean, there's a whole price and dissemination segment in the world, okay, who are actually quite admiring of many things we have done. And I think the consequences of Aadhaar is something which many of them are watching with a great deal of interest. There would be other markets. Now, in some cases, these are cost-related, but can be more developed societies. I think if you look in the medical field, for example, health field, not medical field, I mean, you have generics, you have biosimilars, where our ability to come in the market with a very different cost is a big benefit. And, you know, I remember my first year as ambassador in the U.S., and the big issue at that time, we were actually targeted under the special 301 procedures on this very issue. And, you know, the irony was in this election which held, I mean, if you saw how much of an issue Bernie Sanders, for example, made of this, and yet actually, you know, the entire, the so-called innovator pharma industry was after our blood on this one issue. I mean, they had made it such a big, and you know, the entire IPR debate was skewed, and sort of obligations were suggested which actually had no basis on anything which had been agreed to. So, you know, there would be areas where it's important to position yourself as a mass scale.
Size of your internal
yes, right. There will be areas where you would say, I can deliver very good quality at a much more competitive price than you are paying. But there would also be areas, and I think, for example, what I see happening in defense. You know, we have a trend today of major global defense companies setting up shop in India. A lot of them get, engineering-related innovation done, including in Bangalore. In fact, in the Indian Institute of Science that you spoke about, where the premium is really on the creativity and the innovation. It's not a cost-sensitive issue necessarily, relatively speaking, perhaps. So I think, as in politics, I think in business too, we must be all things to all men. And how to handle that at the same time, I think that is part of the challenge that we face.
One last question before I go to the floor. I mean, the pressure on globalization today in the developed world, because traditionally we've argued, look, the North or the West is for globalization, we must resist globalization. To one, what we've seen happen in Brexit in the United States, that here is a city which is one of the most globalized in the world today, and the pressures that we've seen coming from the US and other places to limit, to constrain that globalization. So we were reluctant and one of the late globalizers. So what should be our policy? I mean, how are we going to deal with the new pressures from those who promoted globalization, because we turned out to be very good students. Now the teacher doesn't like we've been successful. But yet at the same time, the nature of global innovation, the nature of interconnections are so real. What is the strategy for navigating, both sustaining our advantages in a globalization process, while at the same time creating national capabilities to resist setbacks to our strategy? So would you like to go first?
Maybe Dr. Jaishankar will.
Look, in a sense, I touched on it somewhat indirectly, which is that you have the developed societies, mainly the Euro-Atlantic societies, and you have the modernizing economies, mostly, not all of them, Asian. I think today, striking new terms of engagement between these two, that is very much at the heart of the global debate. People spoke of globalization because it meant trade in goods and the flow of finances. But today, when you say, listen, this is a package, you can't do part one and part two and not factor in services accordingly. Now, often you hear this argument, in my society, the mood is against it. Now, what about my society? I also have a mood. I also have my sentiment. So I think today, how to get our point of view across, how to make sure these debates are more reasonable, that more equitable, that the interests of the emerging economies, for want of a better term, I think getting that hurt today is a big issue. And I mean, it's again, that's the way history of the world has progressed. I mean, the up and coming powers have to battle to make their voices heard. But I do see that as a big issue. And the older powers will not yield space readily. I mean, it is again in the nature of their position. So I think many of these issues will be issues of great debate in the coming years, coming months. So watch the space.
Yeah, I think, I'll not be able to kind of give an overview or overall picture, but I'll just give you one example. To my mind, this globalization issue, who is saying that? You know, they keep on changing that their conversation depending on what is the context. So for example, the same guys who are there, they will say, no, this is I'm not going to do that. For example, open APIs and open standards in technology area are very well accepted things. Now, there are these telecom equipments which are being made, and many of these equipments now have what is these biometric sensors, whether they are iris or whether there are fingerprints. And we told some of the manufacturers, saying, their friends, you have this biometric sensor, you must open the APIs of this sensor so that we can do authentication here. Why can't we do that? They said, no, this is proprietary to us. I said, you are the globalized, people who were saying that, we will do everything open, and now you say this is proprietary. Similarly, identity, you are creating identities and you are creating your proprietary identities. So the idea is that, you know, when they realize this as a threat, then they start saying, no, this is not good. And then they, of course, one of the overarching thing is privacy. You know, this will violate privacy. So these are some of the things, you know, which happen. So we have seen this conversation or this articulation getting customized to the need or circumstances. Absolutely.
So I think that sets a good stage. We got nearly, 17, 18 minutes for questions from the floor. So I'm going to take three questions at a time. So please identify yourself, and I know all of you are smart, to pose a single sharp question in a very brief set of seconds. So I see you, yeah.
My name is A.G. Ramakrishna, and I work with a startup firm. My question is to Mr. Sharma. He has explained on the digital infrastructure, the software, and the citizen empowerment. And key part of it is on connectivity. And TRI plays a critical role in that. So what kind of steps, innovations, or policies you are working on to make the connectivity more accessible to the citizens of India?
Thank you. Thank you. I want to take two more questions. Anyone else? There, please. In the third, yeah.
Hello, sir. My name is Srikant. I'm a technologist from Intel. This is a question for both of you. I'm interested to understand the policies relating to academic standards and how they relate to both technology as well as policy.
Thank you. That's a good question. Yeah, there, please. So just identify yourself. So we'll come back to the others. So would you like to?
Sure. I think this is the first one is a very good question as to what TRI is doing, because I am pontificating about things which are not TRI. So let me now talk about things which are TRI. So one is, we are really very, very weak in terms of connectivity, and there is a reason for it. When we, leapfrogged into the mobile revolution, at that time, we just had 20 million landlines. We just had 2 crore telephone lines, fixed telephone lines. And thereafter, no single telephone line has been put up. In fact, all the other lines which were there, they have been sort of uprooted also in the mobile world. So what has happened now, it is not voice anymore, because we have connected 1 billion people with voice, and that's a great work Indian telecom industry has done. But then now the question comes whether this wireless data can really satisfy the demand of data hunger and the kind of applications which are going on. It cannot. So what are the options before us? Options are put more fiber, put more lines. Now that's so difficult to do because you have the right of way permissions and you have all other kinds of issues and also the cost issue. So we are into this situation where the demand is there, and the demand cannot be satisfied unless you have a fixed fiber infrastructure, fixed infrastructure, wireline sort of infrastructure. So we have, thought through this, and there are a couple of things which we have done. One is we have today, how can we increase the wireline penetration? So there is already a wireline penetration of digital cable TV. India has digitized its cable TV network during the last 4 or 5 years. And 31st December is actually the last and the final 4th phase, as they say, of digitization. Now, we have 100 million cable TV homes. And each of these cable TVs with a little bit of upgradation can be used to provide reliable and robust fiber, robust broadband connectivity. In USA and Europe, a large percentage of people use cable TV at home to provide them the digital infrastructure. So we have made a formal recommendation to the government, and we are pursuing with the government, and we are very sure that this will be done. So that's one part, which will, at one stroke, will provide 10 megabits and above connectivity. And there are no right-of-way issues that local cable operator has already solved that issue, or taking somebody's rooftop and taking somewhere. He has done the jugaad. Right. And that's a thing which can be leveraged immediately. So that's one part which we have recommended. We have also recommended the open, you know, the telecom policy 2012 talked about the open sky policy, whereby the broadband, wherever it's not possible to provide fiber, should be able to be provided to those areas. So that's another part. Third most important intervention which is happening is the BharatNet. BharatNet is a 110 lakh crore project, which is actually being implemented, of course, from 2011 onwards. It was NOFN then, and now it's called BharatNet. Now, its aim is to provide optical fiber connectivity to each panchayat, and we have 250,000 of them in our country.
At the village
level. Village level. So basically, just about 2 to 3 villages, the cluster of that, panchayats. So this is a very, very transformational project where you will have, each panchayat will have the point of presence, and thereafter you can use, you know, Wi-Fi, or you can use some other spectrum to basically disseminate to the schools, hospitals, homes. It's possible. You know, once you have that, last mile is an easy thing to happen because you have reached very near the village. So that's another part. We have recommended to the government a public-private partnership model, because we feel that unless there are incentive alignments between the private players, the users, the, you know, suppliers, and the maintenance people, things will not work. So that's third thing which we have done. Lastly, in fact, we had a couple of months back a conference here on the, you know, Wi-Fi hotspots. Because in India, what is happening is everybody is not going to have computers at home. Everybody is not going to have a fiber at home. This too distant a dream. So we have always believed in community infrastructures. So we have common service centers, for example. We have 100,000 common service centers which deliver various kinds of government services. So what we are saying, let us have a situation, let's have an architecture of public Wi-Fi hotspots. Today, this cashless digitization, one of the things which is coming in the way is people do not have, you know, a bandwidth. People don't have the data connectivity. So if you can have community Wi-Fi hotspots, so for example, every grocery shop owner, he just puts up a hotspot. And then we create an architecture whereby this hotspot can be leveraged by anybody whosoever visits the shop. So this is an architecture. What we are trying to create is an interoperable national architecture where, A, I have to authenticate only once, which means I am RS Sharma. This is my telephone number. And already you have that jam trinity where Janadhan, Aadhaar, and mobile. Aadhaar numbers are connected to mobile and also the bank account. So basically, I have a digital identity which I authenticate saying that this is RS Sharma, number one. Number two, I attach a payment instrument with that. So every time I reach a Wi-Fi hot zone, I am just, you know, I am discovered by that zone saying that, friend, here is a Wi-Fi facility available. You want to avail it? You say yes, and you just have to say yes. You don't have to get into the routine of, you know, the OTP will be sent to you, you plug in your mobile number and OTP comes, and then, you know, you do this whole rigmarole every time. So you authenticate once, you just create your you know, payment instrument once. This is like an Uber model, whereby this guy at the, you know, shop, he's just putting up his taxi, he's just putting up his Wi-Fi hotspot. The payment, the logging in, the other kinds of things are done through an interoperable architecture. So I go from place one to place two to city one to city two. Everywhere I am recognized, my payment instrument is recognized, and the cloud manages this whole payment and settlement and other things. So this is another recommendation is going to come in a couple of days. One of our UIDI architects has, and all of you have collaborated in that. In fact, we had a very vibrant one-day workshop in Bangalore here itself, as to how we can create this nationally interoperable Wi-Fi infrastructure. These are some of the things which we are doing.
Academic. He had a... Oh, okay. Look, I mean, I don't think either of us do do education policy, so I really don't know, you know, what... But I'd make one point, though, which is if I were to compare ourselves having lived in China and Japan, I think clearly there is a lot of work to be done in both the scale and the quality of our educational institutions. I think that clearly stands out. And you can also see in many ways it's also a big priority for the government because In fact, we were joking that probably the number of IITs when we finished school are not that different today than they used to be then. Again, that sort of the spread of education, particularly technical education, has been wanting. So when we spoke about that process of change in the last 25 years, one of the areas where we haven't changed as much as we should have in order to take the modernization process forward faster is actually in education.
There was a lady, a young lady, who's trying to ask a question there. Yes, please. Yeah, go ahead. There's a microphone in front of you. No, you just go to the mic. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Rangashri. I'm a law graduate and an aspiring diplomat. My question to Dr. Jaishankar is that, so you mentioned the Indo-Japan nuclear deal, which was recently in the news. And can you explain how tech transfer could happen when the cloud of the unilateral nullification clause is always hanging around us?
Okay, thank you. Is the second question, is that? Yes, please, here.
I've come to attend such an august gathering. My only question is India concentrating on defense-based industries? With the gap being bridged with the present government, so far Army has been staying away from the media glare, I'll put it very subtly. Now, since it is coming out in the open and we are also talking about being a world leader and player, without defense, I don't think it is possible. So what is the amalgamation that is going to take place between the bureaucracy and the defense forces? Do we have a DBI base?
Thank you. Mr. Mohan Das Pai.
Yeah, I got two questions. The first question is, if you look forward 10 years, you'll find that technology is going to differentiate the status of countries around the world. And India is the heart of this technological change along with the United States and possibly China. How will our foreign policy establishment use the Indian technology prowess as part of its foreign policy? That's the first question, because we are right at the heart of it. We missed the Industrial Revolution, we missed the post-war boom, but now we are here. The second question is, in the next 10 years, we're going to see standard setting and much debate happening in the area of, let us say, automated warfare, autonomous robots fighting wars, like the drones of the United States. We're going to see cybersecurity becoming extremely important, control of the internet becoming very important. And all these are debates that are going to reshape the world in the next 10, 15 years. What does the government think of creating the pool of intellectual talent that's required to be part of India when India speaks to the world on reshaping the world in the next 10 years?
Maybe I'll not be able to speak on other questions because they relate to diplomacy, but I think I completely agree with Mr. Mohan Das Pai that while we have a huge number of talent pool and all that, we have not been participating in the standards making exercise. And I think that really differentiates. I mean, we need to learn to participate in that. So much so that even the telecom equipments which come, you know, all these standards are not made by us. So somehow we have been kind of copying and following. Of course, we have made some other standards which in the area which I spoke about, Aadhaar. But that part, there is a need to really create policies and even our academic institutions, for example. I mean, obviously, standard making exercise, bureaucrats can't participate, right? So the academy says we will have to create such conditions. Otherwise, people go there and, you know, they sort of, even if the standard making bodies, people go and थोड़ा बहुत आसान करके अपना come back, you know, not contributed much. And that is very strategic intervention which we need to make. Unfortunately, current levels are not really great. That's the only answer I can provide.
Three quick answers. First, you know, the Japan agreement is important because the Japanese capabilities in civil nuclear power are, they're not only very impressive, they're actually very cost effective. So if we actually collaborate with Japan, the cost of light water reactors will come down. Now, in any complicated transaction, there are risks. And, you know, life, diplomacy, even business is about managing the risks. We have got to a Japan nuclear agreement because we got the nuclear suppliers group, which is like a cartel of nuclear technology providers, to say, okay, we'll do business with India broadly under these conditions. So it's not like the Japanese are asking us for something different that other people are asking us. It is how we manage it, and in the case of Japan, because they have a particular history with nuclear issues, we have probably gone the extra mile to show a degree of sensitivity. But at the end of the day, the answer to you, how do you manage the possibility that something could happen which could nullify international cooperation? It's a risk. It's frankly a question of assessing risks and managing it and putting in place mechanisms which would deal with contingencies which you hope may or may not, low probability contingencies, I would say. On the issue of defense-based industries, yes, I would say there is a clear shift in thinking. I think today there's a strong sense that why is it that India is only a purchaser of finished products in the defense field? And in some way, can we make as part of that transaction the sharing of technology? Now, this is not a new thought. I mean, we've had an offset policy now in place for a number of years. The question is, how do you implement it? You also need to have it's not enough to have a technology demand policy. You have to have a technology absorption capability, and therefore a policy. Now, many countries, not just in defense, have handled this very well. I mean, if you look for, look at China, for example. China has very rapidly assimilated, I'll give you two examples, nuclear reactor technology and high-speed train technology from foreign sources through policies which are designed to encourage, if not actually compel them, to share technologies. But to do that, I must also have the experience and the business and the bandwidth to absorb those technologies. And part of our changes is, have we really built up that capacity? I think that is a bit of a question mark, but there is a change of thinking. I think today the view is that we should move today to expand defense industry much beyond where it stands. On Mr. Mohandas Pai's issue, yes, look, at the end of the day, what do we have in India? We have people, okay, and technology is finally there. So, to my mind, if you say we should be, everybody will play to their strengths. Our strength is people, and therefore our strength should be technology. We have come late on the scene, and technology is a byproduct of a whole lot of other processes, some of which we have debated as part of a larger modernization process. But to the extent you are a source of technology, you are a manager of it, you are these are all hugely important. Foreign policy diplomacy is a objective of influencing so that your desired outcomes come out of a certain process. To the extent you are a major technology player, and I totally agree with you, setting the rules of the game, the standards are part of it. I can see even in the near term, more use of technology in international negotiations. It will be a subject that tech centrality, I think was the word. Tech centrality also applies to diplomacy. That will happen as a subject, as well as a process in a way. But it comes back to one issue. To do that, you need to have the right resources, the right skills. Not all of them. In fact, a large part of it will not be in the government. We have to devise a model for government working with non-governmental organizations, because not knowing what you don't know is itself great wisdom. So I think I can see a lot of new experiences that await us as a consequence.
Thank you. I think that's all the time we have. As the chairman of the first session, I don't want to extend this. I just want to, at this point, really to thank our two speakers. I think both of them, one a policymaker, one a regulator, coming all the way from Delhi to engage with us this afternoon. And I think they set the stage, what I would think, for the expansive discussion that we hope to have in the next day and a half.